No. I consider it was happy childhood. We were four children, and I have an elder brother, Wolf, and then elder sister, Sylva, and my twin brother, Shmuel. And basically, luckily, our father could provide for us, and we didn't feel any problem. And the only problem, as we can say, I fell into anti-Semitism, and you know, we had to fight for our Jewish pride with my twin brother. So it was sometimes a lot of fights, but. Latvia, as I hear, comparing from Ukraine, for example, there was less anti-Semitism. It was not so, and so I cannot complain too much. Let's say it was in moderation, as we can say.
And how was the family, the house? Was it? Mm. How would you describe it?
Well, we can say it's Jewish traditional values, and we can say we celebrated Jewish holidays and. From the very early age, we were brought up in love and I would say awareness of Israel, that we are Jews. We have to be live there, only there we can live, to be a proud and free Jewish people. And basically, it was not a revolution for me to live in Israel from the childhood, as I just told you. I want to be there, and after the Six-Day War, my desires became very powerful, I would say. It was burning me from inside, I can say. What else I can say?
I want to ask you about how Sylva was as a child, because I know she wasn't an ordinary little gentle girl.
Well, I wouldn't complain too much. We were very, very friendly, and my elder brother was like an elder brother. So, but with Sylva, from my point of view, we spent a lot of time together. We played together. I remember all kind of childish children's game and whatever.
Oh, I meant how she was like, because I know she used to beat up other boys in school and stuff like that. So I wanted you to tell me about.
That's the first time I hear about it. Well, maybe because she was grown up with three brothers around her. Maybe somebody I cannot tell anything about her being a tomboy, right? No.
Okay, so if you can, I'm not going to force you.
It's something, maybe, logically you can expect, of course, because she was, as I told you, three brothers, and she had to stand for her right. You know, we were fighting, but not much.
So did she ever defend you, or was it not necessary?
From the elder brother, or from the, well, yeah, maybe, but from my twin brother, I think we were, I could handle him myself.
So you used to fight a lot as brothers?
A lot, yeah, with my twin brother, of course. But my elder brother, Wolf, he was more like an elder brother, 10 years older, so he was like keeping a good check on us.
So you were very close to Yona as well?
Yeah, with Yona until I was seven, when they moved to Poland and then to Israel. We spent a lot of childhood memories with her, and because she is close to my age, you know. So.
Did you understand that she moved to Israel?
I remember we were told not to tell to anybody because it's a secret, whatever. But even at that age, I also wanted to live in Israel. I was 7 years old, I told you, so.
Why did you want to, as a seven-year-old, what did you think Israel was like?
At seven, as I told you, I already suffered from anti-Semitism, you know, on that age. And so in Israel, everybody is Jewish, so that's as much I remember. Maybe later I started to, you know, to like more things about Israel. We can describe, we can tell more in details, but at that age, that's what I remember.
What did you, okay, so later on, what did you think Israel would be like? How did you imagine it?
Well, by the way, from Yona and her parents, we started to get some packages from Israel with clothes, whatever, I remember. And I was, it's very nice. It's, you know, I was maybe like 10 years old, and I started to see that Israel is also a good place to live, you know, what else? But I remember there is stories about the, some Arab 56, it was called Sinai War in 56. I remember that time. I was like 7 years old, approximately. So, and I remember my father was Joseph, or Yosef. He was telling me a lot about this war, I remember. And so I was, you know, for me it was like almost like my country, even that time. Well, the first Zionist, it was Mordechai Lapid. He became religious and he lived in Kiryat Arba and other settlements in Israel. And he was the first ardent Zionist, and he was a friend of Wolf. And I remember he introduced me to this, we call it Rumbali. Movement. Rumbali, it is a place, it's like a Latvian Babi Yar, we can say. Babi Yar, everybody knows, but Rumbali, I'm not sure. That's like 30,000 Jews were slaughtered in the first months of the war, in 41. That's most of my relatives was slaughtered there. So at that place, no there was no memorial, nothing, just forest. And Jews, what is unusual for Soviet regime, Soviet life, started on their own without being told by authorities. They started to go, and Mark or Mordechai Blum, he told me, and Wolf and Sylva, and also my brother, Shmuel, and we, many Sundays we came there to build a memorial place for this. And eventually, authorities with a lot of reluctance and some hindrance, they started to take also do some stuff there to help basically. But it took a while. There was resistance on their part. That's what and in these places we felt like in some kibbutz, by the way. There was we have to do some digging some earth and planting plows, whatever. It was, it was singing the songs after that in Hebrew, you know, after hard work, whatever. And really, it was a high spirit there, and was, and of course, that's one thing. Another thing, in Riga's synagogue, like Simchat Torah, Rosh Hashanah, those holidays were celebrated. It was like a big festival. Even non-Jews were some of my friends, to my surprise, also came because it was so much fun there. And what was, remember those songs, can you believe it's after the Six-Day War, for example, when there was a lot of very, how to say, strong anti-Israeli propaganda. It was vicious, basically. In those days, can you believe that people were like standing, Mi Ata, Israel, Mi La Nisa, Israel. It means, it was like a, you know, it's like demonstration, basically. It was like very exhilarating. It was, well, you know, that's what the things that slowly this and that and some other things, of course. And eventually, Sylva got involved with the Zionist Riga, movement. It was not so much organized; it was more spontaneous, as I felt, like holidays and discussion and studying Hebrew and exchanging books. Most of them, I would say, underground, though it was not illegal, but still. And that's how I get involved with more movements, with what's called samizdat in it means self-printed materials, unauthorized. For Jewish history, Exodus, for example, or pieces of this we distributed. And of course, it was all based on our common desire to live in Israel and try to do something until this day will come one day, as we hoped.
So, do you remember when you heard on the radio about the Six-Day War that Israel won? Do you remember that moment?
Well, in those days, I was already 18, I believe. Right, 18. Well, I knew that you couldn't trust Soviet paper, newspapers, propaganda, whatever. But you have to learn how to read between the lines, you know. By the way, this habit or this skill of mine, I believe still can be used in nowadays, even in free society. Some newspapers or whatever, you have to understand what they really try to say, what they're trying not to say. It's still, but that's what I can say. I remember I came from my college, and I was in college at that time. It was after 2 o'clock, and I hear on the radio that Israel attacked Arabs, but Egypt already shut down like 70 Israeli planes. And I, of course, understood right away something big going on, of course. And I thank God at that time we could listen to the Call Israel. It's a broadcast from Israel in Russian. And that's where I got but much different picture, and eventually, slowly and surely, we got the picture and with celebration. It was every Jew you meet. It was like, did you hear that? You see, you know, it was like a lot of enthusiasm in Riga, at least. I'm not sure Jews all over there, of course, different environment, but in Riga it was like complete unanimous, we can say almost. The Yom Kippur War, it was 73, I was already in jail, by the way, already going a little bit forward. It was also, you will try to understand by Soviet radio, whatever, that situation is not as bad as they try to present. And all of a sudden, I hear that Egyptian eliminating a few tanks that succeeded to cross the Suez Canal. That's where I understood that things are great. And of course, very soon the war was finished with another Israeli victory. Unfortunately, it was not easy victory, we can say.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. So tell me about how you heard the idea of taking a plane.
Okay, it came from me. No, first of all, my sister got married to Eduard Kuznetsov. He was Russian dissident, and he already was 7 years in jail for the anti-Soviet agitation propaganda. So the person I, of course, very much respected and learned a lot from him. And we also discussed all kinds of possibility how to can flee Russia, Soviet Union. It was just a discussion in the kitchen, nothing concrete, of course. Okay. As I mentioned before, I was like a little bit involved with Sylva, with some Zionist movement for immigration to Israel, of course. And all of a sudden, one day, Eduard Kuznetsov told me, you remember we discussed, you know, about what you think there is some people in Leningrad, they have some very good plan to try to flee Soviet Union, and would you join it? I said, yes, you know, and I wasn't afraid too much at that. I didn't feel anything, you know, it's like kind of very theoretical for me at that time. Okay, and it was, I believe, Purim. Then it was on Pesach, like a month later. Another guy came from Leningrad, Butman, I believe, or maybe, I don't remember. Mm-hmm. Maybe I have to. Okay.
No, mm-hmm. Okay.
So it was.
You know what? I would rather unmodify את הקז במש לא מה שאתה יודע אלא מה שקרה לך לא מה ששמעת שקרה רק מה שקרה לך. Like how did you?
Okay.
So you told me Edward told you about
this. Okay. He told me. So if you remember, so okay, a month later. On a Pesach, Passover, he came over to me and say, remember you, I talked to you about this plan. Now I had more details, and they talk about to hijack a plane in the air. They have a pilot, and there was would be like all the details, and that's where I felt it's more real, and I feel a kind of. Some kind of fear, you know, like crossed me, like through my stomach, or maybe from the stomach. I don't remember how it was exactly. So, but I confirmed my concessions. In fact, one of the things that at that time we were very frustrated to leave the Soviet Union legally. There was a few family guys were lucky to get. Permit to leave, but it was like one of thousands, basically. And then the gates were closed for maybe for another, who knows what, at that time. So it was a kind of time that I felt that there is no other future for me, and I didn't feel myself that I'm gonna be happy in Soviet Union with all the communism and anti-Semitism, whatever. So everything was. And then, of course, later we start to get more details, You no, know, I can go into more details if depends on the, your questions, of course.
Well, did you talk with your second? Did you talk with your brother and sister about the consequences? I mean, were you worried that you might get arrested or die?
Okay. Eduard Kuznetsov, he is the most experienced and the most trusted, I think, person among us who knew what he's talking about. He told me, if we are caught, and there is a big chance that we're going to be caught, I will get 10 years in, and he will get 15 years. That's what his was estimate. Well, of course, we're being... how to say, watched closely by KGB. There was a, our telephone was wired, whatever. And, but we knew that all, and he told me that, but if we are careful, maybe we can be successful in this. That's approximately. Yeah, the more I knew, there was one plan, then another plan. I would not, okay, at this moment, go too much into this. But the latest, the last plan, whatever we had, it was pretty, I think, feasible. Of course, we all knew that we have to be careful with KGB can arrest us. But some people were more optimistic, some were more pessimistic. I was. What I hear now, or I was pretty optimistic, I would say. I knew there is danger, but maybe I was young. I was 21 years old. Maybe you don't worry too much at that time.
So you woke up in the morning, what did you pack?
Well, we're supposed to come as if we're going for the hiking, like 3 days hiking. And I had a, also, I had my, the only one nice business suit I had also with me for some reason. Yeah, it would be difficult to explain why I have it there. And we had to bring some food for 3 days in case our plane will be out of fuel in Finland. We have to cross by foot to Sweden. It can be like hundreds of miles, who knows. So we had to, that's the plan was. And that's it. Oh, I have, of course, some rubber sticks with us, just in case we had some problems to pacify the pilots. We prepared some sleeping sacks for them and tied their hands, and that's, I'm going into details, but that was also part of them.
How did you say goodbye from your parents?
Well, that was very tough. We were, we agreed we will not tell to anybody that we are on this I would say action.
Let's start this sentence again. Mm-hmm. So how did you tell your mom, Ed?
I'm sorry, I still feel sorry about this, that we didn't tell anything to our father. My mother were already died a year ago before that. And my father didn't know anything about it, and my also brother Shmuel didn't know. He was not involved at this moment. And we're not supposed to tell to anybody. Take three.
Okay.
אבל לפעמים צריך להסתכל על המצלמה, לא? מדי פעם?
רק אליה. זה הכי טוב.
אני...
את היחידה.
אני היחידה בעולם הזה. אוקיי, אני רוצה שתספר לי. I want you to tell me about the day of the hijacking. Just not the other group, just your group. What happened to you, from your point of view? The whole day, what happened?
That's... Well, we started to act upon the our plan. The plan was my brother Wolf and me and Mendelevich. We, I believe, we had to take a plane from Riga to Leningrad and arrive like a day before the action, or D-Day, we can say. And we had to meet with some other people there, and then to go to the forest next to the this airport, in a local airport or commuter airport, Smolny, in the Leningrad area. And there in the forest, okay. There in a, there in the forest, we're supposed to spend a night, and we had like a camping there, and we had some last dinner, and we were joking, we were wondering where we would have next dinner, in KGB jail or in Stockholm somewhere in Sweden, in Freedom. Unfortunately, the first option became real, and we, what else we did? I played some cards, preference, you know, it's like bridge basically with my brother a little bit, and that's about it, that's what I remember. And we came in the morning, the next morning, the day we had supposed to fly to Sweden, to jail or to Freedom. We came to the airport and with a backpack, you know, like a hikers, and what else? There we met some other people of our group. We saw the Dymshits and Kuznetsov. He came with his friends Fedorov and Murzhenko. They came like a separate group, as if then we saw Dymshits with his family came. And I believe Altman and Bodnia, I think they also were with us. I don't remember that, basically. And
so you arrived to the airport, and yeah, did you know the KGB was following you?
No, somebody was like, oh, this guy looks strange, you know, maybe, but, you know, I was not so experienced. For me, it looks normal. But then I saw a lot of KGB around us, but later I learned that. At that time, I was pretty, my main concentration was because my job was to take over one of the pilots, to put him in a sleeping bag, make sure, you know, he would not be, you know, no surprises and no, not to be hurt, whatever. But that's what, and I was thinking how I should do this, and how take his hand, whatever, to take his, but his mouth, you know, I was like, that was, I was preoccupied with this thinking. And I didn't think too much about other stuff. I was too busy with this. I remember then there was announced on the boarding for the plane, and a small plane, it's like a commuter plane, it's like 12 seats, you know, like this kind of, if you have two planes, it's like a kind of historical, you know, ancient plane. What? Can I curse in English at least?
No, the English is good.
It's fine. אני
זמן אני זמן נחון אני לא חולק כל הזמן יסתכל עליך אני
אני
כשאני גם מתרכז אני צריך אני ככה מסתכל גם ברעיונות בעבודה אני יודע אני שמתי לב שאני אני מנפיל ככה
אני גם אתה יודע אני גם כזאת אני מסתכלת לצדדים כי אני נזכרת בדברים
חבל
טוב אבל בסמה זה לא טוב להסתכל בכלל לא again,
let's talk
about that, okay?
No, before how you got cut, I want to talk again about the what was your part again in the group?
What my part?
What was your
okay,
job?
My part in the group. I was like a muscle man. I don't want to have any association with the hijackers of the, but if you don't mind. So my job was to grab the first pilot and drag him from the. From the cockpit, there was supposed to be two pilots, us. We were 12, two pilots, the crew, and nobody else, right? And there's no other passengers, only us. So it was a relatively easy job, as we thought. So my job was to grab this first pilot, put him on the floor, and some other like Bodnia, for example. He's just to help me, and we had to, and maybe whoever was available, and my brother Wolf was supposed to take care of the other pilot. He was opening the door at that time because it was all on the ground, by the way. You know, during the middle landing, that's where the takeover should take place. And that's where also in this airport, another four members of our group supposed to join us. It was Sylva, Boris Penson, Ari Hnoch, and Mary Hnoch. So they were supposed to wait us and join after taking over the plane. And we're having our own pilot, and after they board, and we will leave two Soviet pilots on the ground in sleeping bags. The plan was to fly to Sweden, Boden, that's the name of the town. You can find it on the map.
So tell me about the moment of the arrest. What do you remember from your point of view? What did you think?
I remember that arrest that they called for boarding the plane, and they so there was our plane. It was on the there was like small, you know, just in front of the plane was standing, and the KGB guy, apparently we at that time we didn't know, of course, he's KGB. He was like a director, standing here, and on the same time they called for another plane, kind of, and they were all KGB was standing. They were standing next to us, like two lines. And at some point he said, begin, you know, like, or start it, you know, like the command. And everybody like jumped the two KGB guys. Some jumped from the plane, some from the bushes, some were with assault guns and whatever. And the two guys, they were not very strong, by the way. At that time I did a lot of sports, gymnastics, whatever. I could easily, I think, handle those two, but I saw there is no chance to do anything, so I didn't resist. They forced me into the floor, my hands behind me, put the handcuffs. That was, and after that there was a long story of the imprisonment, of course. I was thinking, oh shit, it didn't help, but it didn't work out, better say. Apparently they knew about our plan, that was my thing. Then I saw my brother, Wolf, he got a blue eye from somebody hit his face, I guess. And and I felt sorry, and I saw him, they hit you, asking him, he said yes, like this. And then I saw Dymshits was like, also, there was like a lot of commotion. Yeah, and I felt like, okay, it didn't work out. That was, apparently now I'm gonna be in jail. That's what I was thinking.
Did you think about what happened to your sister, the Sylva?
No, because, they were supposed to join us after the middle landing, it means, but we were arrested just before the boarding the plane. So they were, and I learned only, I don't know when, maybe half a year later, how they were arrested and all the story. They were arrested, as I know now, a few hours before us, and when they were sleeping at night in some camping. Where we're supposed to have a middle landing, they were arrested there.
Were you offered anything during interrogation? Did they tell you, or if you asked for?
Well, they wanted to tell me who told me. I refused to say that until later during the investigation. They convinced me that they know everything, and they admitted that Bootman was the guy who told us about the plan and whatever. But we agreed that it was Edward's idea that there is no point to try to conceal the fact that we're trying to go to Israel, and we don't have to, regret whatever we did, but our intentions was to live in Israel, that's all. We could regret on our methods, maybe there was, we had to force the, you know, there is some violence involved, still, we have those two pilots, right? So we can say that we can definitely regret about this. But not to regret about our goal to live in Israel. That was the agreement between us.
But did they offer you? Did they say, if you say you're sorry, you get less?
Well, they tried to influence me. They used somebody who was informer sitting with me in jail. And he tried to moderate my behavior or my stance. If, for example, and he tried to tell me that if I don't sincerely regret whatever, I would get more years. think about it, you know, it's better to say, yeah, who cares, say whatever you want, you know. I say, I can say that I, you know, that I regret whatever I wanted to do this thing, but I would never regret that I want to live in Israel. That's my position was. And that, and during the, after the trial, they tried to, there was a pressure to make us, what's called, to stand up on the path of re-education, whatever they call it. It means to denounce our views and try to be, we're going to be now a good Soviet citizens, and that's, so we didn't, well, basically to give up the idea to live in Israel. That was the pressure, but they figured out that it was in vain and there was no point even to discuss it. And also they knew that there was a lot of pressure from the West, from the Israel, to on our behalf, and that's also lifted our spirit. So this way we were, how to say, resistant, we were resistant to any pressure, put it this way.
That was after the trial, but before the trial, you told me, and I would like you to repeat that you thought maybe we made a mistake.
Well, it's true.
We thought maybe we made a mistake, because no.
Well, what I can say, during the, we were sitting during the investigation in half a year and complete isolation. There was no lawyers, no newspaper, you know, you have no idea what's going on outside and no contact with your whoever relatives. So at that time, what I knew, we tried to do something, it failed. Also, I knew that a lot of, there was arrest. Throughout the Soviet Union, all Jewish groups that were involved in Jewish activity, Zionist movement, they also were arrested and whatever. And basically, I felt like we, you know, were like screw up. You know, there was only bad thing happened because of our venture, if it's the proper word to say. So I was not proud of whatever I did. You know, it was like failure to me. And when I discovered that something good happened because of this, after the trial, when we get access to some letters from our parents and relatives, and that's where I will learn, even during the trial, by the way. By the way, Eduard Kuznetsov, I remember his words. After the verdicts, after the, he was sentenced to death, we were sitting in the same truck, whatever, for prisoners. It's called Varanok in Russian. It basically, in English, there is another word for this, where the prisoners are transferred from jail to jail. We're sitting, I was sitting next, isolated, but in a close confinement, but we could talk a little bit. And he told me, some of our friends get, it's emotional because I remember my feeling. Okay, at that time he told me that some of our friends get permit to leave to Israel. It's funny, I get it, it's difficult to say, but so, and it was after death sentence. I remember my feeling, even still it's fresh, you know. And I was at some point, I feel like death sentence, and at least somebody got, so I have to recover a little bit, but somebody got freedom because of us. So it was not that bad after all, you know. There was some good about this. Sorry, I can't control my emotions, but okay, I hope I recover. And then we start to get letters. So many, there's so much struggle, so much noise, and there is so much pressure, and all over the world they talk about you. And it was spirit lifting event, and I was celebrating every day. Every time I hear some news, like 20 families get permission, more 20 families every week. Some people are leaving. It was unbelievably strong feeling for me. So I felt it. So that's where we felt it was not in vain. That's where we felt it. We succeeded basically. It was very emotional for me at that time. And of course, when we after the sentences and this, we all brought to prison camps in Siberia somewhere or close to it. We got together, and it was after that our spirit, I think, never went down. We were always feel great because of whatever happened. Sorry, when I get older, I guess it's really difficult for me to talk about it. Sorry, it was. I remember like when I, after release from jail, after 8 years I spent, and there are some American ladies from some church, some nuns, they came to visit me, you know, in my house in Riga. It was very emotional for me, you know. I remember this, it was like, you know, I can't even now, it's like live all over again in this, it was, you know, all of a sudden you see, Westerners, you know, like because you were sitting like in a hall somewhere and you don't see anything, and all of a sudden you see some free people coming to you. You know, it was also a very strong feeling. You know, I was like weeping, like now. Now it's much less. I need to. One second. But I'm feeling embarrassed a little bit. Sorry. let me. Oh, now I'm fine. Okay, let's talk about some others because, shit. You know. Sometimes I get certain things get emotional, put it this way. Yeah, and of course, when I came to Israel, I still, by the way, when I came to Penson, all of a sudden I see all these people with the cameras. It also was, remind me some, I also felt like a surge of emotions, you know, but I could overcome it. It is some reminiscence, put it this way. Some more questions, please.
Yes. Do you remember what Sylva said on the trial?
Yeah, of course. In fact, my position was, as I told you, I was not very proud whatever we did. You know, I felt we have to what's called to bite the bullet. Means we failed, we have to live with this and try to get out with least possible damage and not to try to aggravate the situation. And Sylva was at that time was behaving, I thought.
Because the trial day was December 15th, and first understand was.
The trial started December 15, 1970, and our hijacking attempt was in June 15, so half a year after, right, approximately, yeah, half a year after. And the sentences were carried out on December 24th.
Yeah, but I want to go way before that, just the trial day. Can you just tell me, you were there, right, as a witness, so you saw Sylva, your sister,
yeah,
going up on the first, so just tell me about this part.
Okay, at that time, it looked like our position was trying not to be a hero, not to speak anything, you know, too impressive, whatever. So, you know, my position was like, I want to be in Israel, I try to explain why, you know, whatever. So there was nothing against Soviet Union, and I try to explain. So we try to make it as this action as humane as possible. We try to, you know, not to hurt too much, hopefully, pilots. Okay, about Bregas, Okay, sorry. Yeah. Okay, can we continue?
Yes,
starting. Okay, so as I said, our position, everybody try not to aggravate, try to speak to the. And Sylva was also speaking more or less that she tried to argue certain whatever. But after the prosecutor asked for the very harsh sentences, like death sentences for Mark Dymshits and Eduard Kuznetsov, and 15 years for many, like Menilevich and Fyodorov, Mruzhenko, whatever. So she, it did something in her, I guess. And she, that time, she apparently decided to speak out, to say whatever she thinks about them, and to say the whole truth and nothing but the truth, it's called. And she said that im ishkachech Yerushalayim tishkach imani v'tidbaki v'tidbaki pam. Look at im ishkachech Yerushalayim tidbak imani tidbak leshoni l'choki v'v im ishkachech Yerushalayim tidbak im ishkachech Yerushalayim Imishkachech Yerushalayim, Tishkach Yemeni, V'tidbak. Okay. She said, Imishkachech Yerushalayim, Tidbak Lushani Elchoki, V'Beshanar Abba Yerushalayim.
Okay, so you don't remember what else she said?
I don't remember everything. She said some other things, for example. She couldn't understand how come prosecutor asked for so harsh sentences, and details I don't remember, but that's what, you know, certain things. But this, and after this, whatever the speech of hers, I felt that she's apparently going to be in trouble, because it will definitely, she will get more, you know, because Russians are they're very unforgiving for somebody who is trying to stand up and speak out.
Do you feel that what she said, since she was the first, that it affected you and the other people on trial, what you said?
Well, I felt that she spoke much more harsh, and I felt my speech was not as strong as hers. And I feel that I had to, I'm not sure. Well, of course, it's lit up our spirit, you know. Maybe she gave us kind of how we have to behave in the future, and we have to stand up for our, and not to be ashamed, and not to be humble about whatever we did. Well, I was lucky. I was my brother Wolf 1 year in a rabbi camp that I was brought there, so we were together for 1 year. And Sylva was in adjacent camp nearby. And the first year, when I went to the hospital, there is another zone, you know, another camp near, and this camp was with the hospital. It was very close to her. And somebody told me that if I stand up on some kind of shed, I can yell and she will hear me. Maybe she will, so you can see her. And that's what, where I could yell her, and this, she can yell me back, and I could see her. It's from a distance about like 100 meters approximately, we could speak. It was, and after that, I got some punishment from the camp authorities, depriving me from using the canteen in the camp. But it was money well spent, whatever we call. So I didn't regret, of course. And later, I was in another camp, close also, smaller camp. It was also not far, and we called and from time to time. We could yell to each other. When it was safe, more or less. We could also exchange some letters illegally through, we bribed some guards. So we have some communication, you know.
What did you yell to each other, for example?
Well, what we, just to basically to support each other, some news and whatever was, I don't remember exactly, but.
Did you ever sing to each other?
Huh?
Did you ever sing?
Sing?
Yeah, sing. Shouting
to each other, no. With Sylva, no. I don't think so. She was too far away. It was like approximately 100 meters or 110
so
yards.
So you're like, hi, hey, how are you? Like what?
Yeah, you know, something like to wave a hand, or you can basically. Maybe how you feel? Did you get my last illegal correspondence? We can say SMS, right? Like now. That's this kind of things I remember. And at some point, I remember I was sent to prison jail, like for a punishment or punishment cell. And later I discovered also that she was also sent for some misbehavior, whatever. So, and after that, I never seen her again. Only after I got her letters when she was released 4 years after, in 74, she started to get her letters from Israel. But that's how it was. That's a good point. I think somebody said we got some rumors that she was sent to on a what's called she was taken away from the prison. And I think
can you say Sylva and not she?
I think first we got rumors she was sent away from the camp to some place. We could always try to figure out where she might be going, but also this was a time when there was a lot of pressure from the United States, and there was a possibility of Soviet concession, and we knew that we are part of the deal might be, and we had a lot of expectations that something good can happen, and but we didn't know for sure. But at some point we got a letter from home that I think even it was a cable. We got a cable that Sylva was released, and she is with all the hoopla, whatever was about it and around it. And then we get letters, and we got, so it was pretty happy days for us. And remember, nobody punished us for any misbehavior. There was a good time to be in the camp in those days. And Sorry.
So tell me about the day of your release, because I think you are the only one who were, no, not the only one, but one of the few who were not.
Yeah.
You were sitting the whole time, you were the whole time.
Yeah, I spent until the last day. So I spent 8 years, and June 15, 1978, I was released. Well, it's nothing comparing to other guys. They spend almost 9 years. Some Mendelevich, I think, 11 years. Fyodorov and Murzhenko, they were the only who spent so many years, and they were not released before.
It's 14. You said June 15, so that's the same day you did.
Yeah, the same day. Yeah, exactly. So, okay. But like I was.
Just tell me. My
last.
You woke up, and what happened that day?
It was not exactly like this. Last year and 4 months, maybe, I was, as a punishment for misbehavior, I was sent to Vladimir jail, and it was not a camp, it was a jail. So it was for, there was a, I was together with Yosef Mendelevich and Arye Hnoch. We were at some point even in the same cell. It was pretty much a very good time for us because we could speak in Hebrew. And we all study Hebrew and we study also English. And that's where I studied my English. רגע, רצית להסביר איך אנחנו משתחררים בדרך כלל.
אני רוצה ש... לא, אני רוצה שאתה תספר לי, אני יודעת איך, יש לי סיפורי רקע, אני רוצה שאתה תספר לי.
איך אני? כן.
לא, אל תיכנסו לי פה,
לא, כמה מילים, זאת אומרת. זה לא היה יום אחד פתאום אמרי.
לא, לכו משם. היי, ביי. לא, מפה, משם, לכו. טוב.
לא, זאת אומרת, זה היה דווקא... דווקא זה מעניין קצת, קצת אנושי.
לא, אני, כן, אבל אני רוצה לשמוע...
קצת אנושי שלי.
מה?
קצת אנושי יותר, אני לא... אני אומר...
כן, כן, אנושי.
כן, זה מה שכוונתי,
כן. לא, פחות מעניין אותי הטכני, יותר מעניין אותי מה אתה הרגשת ביום הזה. What did you feel? Are we running?
כן.
No skateboard, no cousins.
כן, זהו.
Yes. So what did... How was your day like that?
Well, before my release, KGB brought me from jail to the KGB jail in Riga. It was maybe like a few hundred yards from my home where I lived. We were lucky to live close to the KGB jail, okay? So in, the day before, they were my parents, basically my father, brought me civil clothes, and it was, remember, Wrangler jeans and a shirt, you know, because we were in prison, robes, you know. So in that morning, like five in the morning, they told me that, okay, what you, that's, dress you this, put on this clothes and, okay, and they opened the cell and they got my belongings and for me it was a pretty interesting or strong feeling, you know, to put civil clothes after like 8 years of having a prison robe, you know, and it was pretty fashionable at that time, those jeans, you know, for me it was very, one of the strong moments, I would say, of release. And when I came home, my father put Hatikva on the, you know, on a tape recorder. So I was like climbing up the fifth floor, whatever, and just it was pretty strong. I feel like emotional about it, and, you know, when I came home.
And you saw your twin brother as well.
Brother-in-law. Shmuel, at that time, unfortunately, Shmuel, because he was helping us when he was free, and he didn't take part in this hijacking, what's called. Because of this... טוב.
אבל הגעת לארץ ו... תספר לי פשוט על הקטע שירדנו.
טוב, נמשיך באנגלית, כן?
Yes, of course, of course.
Okay. So how was to come to Israel? Well, Sylva came to meet me in Austria, and I flew from Moscow. So first from Riga, I took a train, a night train to Moscow, and from Moscow I took a plane to Vienna, Austria, and that's where Sylva came in Israel to meet me there. And that was the first time I saw her after many years in Vienna. And we spent three very nice days in traveling all kind of places, and Israeli people from the Israeli embassy helped us to, you know, in Vienna, whatever. And then we flew to Israel, and when we came to Israel, you know, the first thing I saw, there's a big crowd in on a tarmac, you know, on where the close to the airplane landed. So it was a lot of my friends, relatives, and it was very emotional, and I was overwhelmed with this. It was.
What did you do on the first year that you were in this?
Well, first a month or something, I lived with Sylva in her apartment, and she was like my secretary, because at that time I got a lot of media attention, and almost every day I had a few interviews. It was very difficult, by the way. Now it's much easier, by the way. And but at that time it was like interviews, this and newspaper, another newspaper, TV, whatever. It was pretty interesting, but it's also pretty difficult for my psychic, I would say, after the prison, you know, it was like being overwhelmed with this. Well, that's what the whole purpose. In every interview, we were mentioning that there is still my friends and my brother at that time was still there, and at some point I took part in some speaking tour in Europe and in U.S., speaking out about, and you know, that was the idea basically to remind people that there's still our friends and brothers are still there, and we have to, you know, keep the pressure on.
So tell me about the day, the hour, the minute that you find out that your brother is free. How did you find out?
I believe somebody told me. I don't remember even. I didn't. It was like a rumor at the beginning, you know. I don't remember exactly, in fact. But somebody called me, and then eventually, it was confirmed. Sylva went to New York, I guess, to meet Eduard Kuznetsov, there, her husband, and. Then five of my friends and my brother Wolf came to Israel, and there was a big, government organized and welcome given to them, including Menachem Begin and I think all the basically ministers of the cabinet. And so it was happy days for us. And Sylva was there, of course. And at that time I was already like 8 months already in Israel. So I was almost Israeli at that time. That's how I felt. But as I mentioned before, we studied Hebrew. By the way, study Hebrew, it's not like another language. In Soviet Union, Hebrew is considered illegal language. So they were chasing, they were trying to confiscate all our books, or even our handwritten stuff, they were confiscated. But there was some kind of struggle. At some point they let us do it, you know, because they understood that it will not stop, even on the contrary, it will encourage us. And that's what happened, see? And like the same year, I could study in Tel Aviv University with my Hebrew, you know, still it was not good enough, but somehow I could finish and graduate from, thank God, to our Hebrew studies. By the way, Shimon Levit and late Zev Mohilever, was my first of my major, I would say, teachers, because before that I also studied some Hebrew, but not as efficient. But this was in a prison with a discipline, with a, you know, with exams and whatever. It's pretty tough. אני כבר מזמן לא סיפרתי על הדברים האלה, אני מרגיש שהם not as...
למה? זה היה טוב.
אני מרגיש ש... אל תחשבי שזה... אני בקלות קורא את הכתב יד שלי. עתק ש... שאתה שנקרא הכל, מה זה בחייך? זה הרבה מתאים זמנים.
זה אני אמרה שם.
ככה נוח לך או שזה תוכל להחזיק את המכתב יותר למעלה קצת? איך, תגיד לי?
סתם, פרנס, נהייתם.
אם לא,
הוא
ישנה.
בסדר, אני
אנסה
לרדת
גורם. סבבה.
זוכרת
המכתב הזה, ישראל? רגע, אני אמרתי שאני אקרוא את זה לפני.
כן.
סתם שם כך את... так что... нашего сабры будет отличаться от нашей нашим отцатом да нашим саб то от пам наша сабра будет отличаться от нашей другие будущие у моего заботы. Другие будут у него заботы. А другие будут. И очень хочется знать, как вы его назвали. И они лохо сейчас, как мне, за некотавты, чем на улад Ахьян, что ли, решен был
найти. И получить.
Где были бы все. Я же надеюсь увидеть... я надеюсь увидеть вас всех, да. Если это, они пошут их как фамилия Лобарур. Они так и еще до того, как мой племянник научится ходить, а если и позже, то я... А если позже, то я согласен с этим. Пишу обязательно, как у вас... А, напишите обязательно, как у вас вообще проводят, как у вас проходят праздники прямо к нам или через папу. Или через папу. Ранее, значит, 15 ноября. Что такое? זה הכל, כן? ברור השם. צ'יס פאפה. אפשר לגמור פה. טוב, זהו.
אוקיי. אז תחזיק את הדף יותר גבוה, כי הראש שלך
כרגע נורא למטה. אז כי זה תרים למטה, גם זה פה. טוב, אז מה, צריך להדביק פה עם ה...
לא.
איך אתה... טלפרומטר, אין לכם?
אין לנו טלפרומטר, אנחנו לא רק ניקח משפטרים.
בוא נראה, איך אתה רוצה להחזיק את המכתב?
בוא ניקח, האור בא משם, זה גם, אפשר קצת לשנות?
לא,
שף!
כן,
אוקיי, אבל צריך שיהיה קצת יותר אור, הנה.
אתה יכול להחזיק אותו כאן יותר?
אני יכול, אבל שמישהו יחזיק את היד שלי. בסדר, אני אשתדל.
אתה יכול?
כן.
אוקיי.
זה לא צריך, נכון?
לא.
תודה.
מה?
Шалом, дорогие мои. Во-первых, я хочу поздравить тебя, дорогая Танечка, с сыном, который стал первой саброй в нашей семье, а также Марика, молодого папу. Женю и Абрашу поздравить, надо поздравить также, так, поскольку они являются для, для меня странным, что они и бабушки, и дедушки сейчас. Жизнь нашего Сабры будет отличаться от нашей, будет отличаться от нашей. Другие будут у него заботы. Очень хочется знать, как вы его назовете, и получить фотокарточку, где были бы вы все. Я же надеюсь увидеть вас всех еще до того, как мой племянничек научится ходить. А если и позже, то я согласен с этим. Мне часто в письмах передают от вас всех приветы и пишут обо всех, что происходит, и это большая помощь для меня и для нас всех. И это все действительно помогает. И это помогает нам не падать духом и надеяться на скорое освобождение. Но пока, чтобы не терять даром время, я и Вульф с нашими товарищами изучаем иврит и все то, что может пригодиться в будущей жизни. Стараемся отмечать все еврейские праздники. Вчера отмечали Пурим. Конечно, не было у нас традиционных хаминташин, но я знаю, очень было хорошо, и пели мы те песни, которые мы знали, и читали стихи в связи с праздником. И, в общем, все было, как говорится. Вас же разрешите поздравить с Песах, праздником свободы. Напишите обязательно, как у вас вообще проходят праздники, прямо к нам в лагерь или через папу. Первый сабры в нашей семье, а также Марика молодого папу, Женю Абрашу, ставшими, как это и не является для меня странным, бабушкой и дедушкой. Жизнь нашего сабры будет отличаться от нашей жизнь нашего сабры будет отличаться от нашей. Другие будут у него заботы. Очень хочется знать, как вы его назвали, и получить фотокарточку, где были бы вы все. Я же надеюсь увидеть вас всех еще до того, как мой племянничек научится ходить. А если и позже, то я согласен и с этим. Часто тут не я, Лобарупа, часто в письмах передают мне, видимо, окей, Кенере, мне, дозмета, топ, мне. Мне часто в письмах передают, что вы... Мне часто в письмах передают от вас приветы и пишут все, что вы делаете в нашу помощь. И пишут все, я думаю, все, и пишут все, что... Все, все, что вы делаете в нашем... И пишут обо всем. Ну ладно, все. Все, что вы делаете в нашем... В нашем все, это действительно помогает нам не падать духом и надеяться на скорое освобождение. Но пока что... Но пока, чтобы не терять даром время, я и Вульф с нашими товарищами изучаем иврит и все то, что может пригодиться, и все, что может пригодиться. Пригодится в жизни. В жизни. Пригодится. Так, надеюсь, пригодится. Так, стараемся отличать от... стараемся отмечать свои, стараемся отмечать все еврейские праздники. Вчера у нас отмечали Пурим. Конечно, не было у нас традиционных, так понимаю, да, традиционных гаменташин, но было, я бы сказал, очень весело. Что-то у меня, но было очень, это неправильно, то есть было очень весело. Было очень весело. Так, омазера. Было очень весело. Читали. Пели песни, потом собирали Пурим, Хагагну. Пели песни, читали стихи в связи с этим праздником. Весь этот... Вас же... Ага. Окей. We're getting there. Мы умрем. Вас же... Разрешите поздравить с Песах... Праздником свободным, праздник свободы, я полагаю. Свободы. Так. Немного.